Hello, welcome to Tight Lines. This week, we're turning our attention to predatory species pike, plus perch and zander, that are usually at their very best at this time of year. Many people consider them the Mr. Nasties of the coarse fishing world, a reputation they certainly don't deserve. Luckily, helping us catch more of them is one of the Mr. Nices of the coarse fishing world, Eric Edwards, who joins me in the bothy to chat all things predator, whether that's lure or bait fishing. Eric was a member of the England lure fishing squad in 2013's World Championship, so certainly knows his stuff. Also coming up on today's show, there's bankside action from a very wet session I endured on the Grand Union Canal with Sam and Gary Edmonds, two of Eric's fellow England lure squad members. We also get out with reporter Andy Ford on a visit to some southern river fisheries to assess the damage caused by the exceptionally high rainfall this winter. There'll be my regular advice in Fishery Focus too, as I look at the weekend's conditions and the sport in store for fly, sea and coarse anglers around the UK. Well, thanks for coming in, Eric, today. Journey OK, was it? It's been a bit fraught the last couple of days.
The roads are as clear as anything.
Really? Yeah,
the bad weather's put everybody off.
Oh, good luck. Well done. And this is a bit of an omen for you, because last time you were in, I understand that when you left, you had a very, very good session straight after.
Well, yeah, if you recall, Keith, you actually recommended pike fishing on the River Wye.
Yeah.
And I took your cue, and I did a bit of that. I did quite a bit of it. This is a fish that I caught on the Wye on a lure.
Yeah.
That was 27 pounds, 4 ounces.
Really? Wow.
But on the same day, I had fish of 26.9, 23.5, 19.5, and 9 pound a thrown in for good measure.
Wow, incredible. I know Nigel, by the way, goes to the Wye a bit piking, and he's had trouble catching the 20, but he's eventually got one. But where have you been doing most of your fishing this year recently?
Well, I'd like to have been on the Wye.
Yeah.
But the Wye's been a complete washout. I started off on the Wye, I had a couple of good fish in November, and then the rains came, and it's been up and down and up and down, and it's really not been worth fishing. It's even been dangerous to fish.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's not worth doing. But there's plenty of fish about in other places. We'll find out a bit more about that later on. Now, I know Eric had hoped to do a pike film for us on the River Wye, as he says. Unfortunately, the dangerously high water level saw that one off. I thought it might be a good opportunity to get out and target some big perch with lure experts Gary and Sam Edmonds on their local river. Again, the rain put paid to that one. We were left with one option, so we went for it. It had to be one of my most miserable days on the bank ever. Well, the River Lee's completely out of sorts, so Sam's brought me today to the Grand Union Canal near Tring. And the beauty of this is, we're up in the Chilterns, it's high up, there's no rivers flowing. All the water in here comes out the reservoirs. In the summer, it's chocolate brown when the boats go backwards and forwards. It's lovely and clear, Sam. Looks spot on. Good choice.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's completely different to what we've been fishing for the, you know, past couple of months. A lot of the rivers and even the reservoirs that have had coloured water from the rivers being pumped into them.
Yeah.
They've been really, really coloured. So this is makes a change, actually.
But it's virgin territory for both of us with regards to lure fishing.
Yeah, this is only my second trip along the Grand Union, so I'm looking forward to it.
Let's see what we can find out.
Yeah.
We'll go that way.
Yeah, okie doke then.
All right, mate. Fished this area, right around, fan cast the whole area, tried it slowly across the middle, just lifting and dropping. Now we're leapfrogging each other. I'm going to just go the other side of the bridge past these moored barges. Well, this is a rig. I've left that tag end of line on there so you can see. It's a size 10 hook on 12 pound fluorocarbon monofilament, and that's a twitch tail grub I've got on there now, and the idea is as I lift that up and drop it, this acts like a wounded fish and the tail really vibrates and twitches. It's got a little tiny thicker bit on the end, you can just see, and that really vibrates, almost throbs in the water. Now you can adjust how high you have this off the bottom, of course, by where you clip the weight on the line. I like that about sort of about 20 centimetres, no, about 20 centimetres off the bottom. And I like it about there because that should be in the perch's eye line. Fish don't lay on the bottom, they sit just above the bottom. And as I lift that and drop it down again, that should any predatory fish, perch, pike, even chub here, that can just wave about in front of it and hopefully it'll have a lunge at it.
Well, I started off fishing a shad on something called an ultra head or a shaky head. So basically what that is, that's an offset hook with a weight fixed on the front of it. And it's almost like a jig head really, but I've just switched to a twin tail. Just going to cast tight to the barge, keep my rod tip up all the time, feeling for any bites, and then as soon as it hits the bottom, I'm just going to lift the rod tip up, wait for it to hit the bottom again, and just hop it all the way back to my feet.
I thought they might chase something like a crankbait. Yeah. Well done, Sam.
That was worth a change.
Was that first chuck?
First cast on the crankbait.
270. Look, thicker in the landing. That's a nice fish, though, mate. Well done.
A little bit smaller.
That was disdain, Sam. That was disdainful, that was.
Well, I've just switched over to a crankbait and I've just caught two fish. Crankbaits can be a really, really effective bait for perch and they're very good for searching for fish. You know, you can cover a lot of water and a lot of ground quickly and, you know, as I say, they're ideal for searching and finding shoals of perch like we've just found here. And I'm just trying to make the crankbait look like an easy target, really. Just giving it very small twitches, making it look different to any other, you know, prey fish that they're seeing, so it just looks like it's injured. Well, I've been using a crankbait for most of the day, but I've decided to switch to a spinnerbait. Similarly to a crankbait, it's a lure that I can fish quite fast and it's ideal for searching for fish. You know, it's a power fishing tactic and that's what the American bass anglers would call it. Now, spinnerbaits are a very versatile lure. The way I've been fishing it today, and I've been casting out, waiting for it to hit the bottom. The beauty of the spinnerbait is that it's a lure that sinks very, very slowly and the blades flutter as it sinks and you often get a lot of fish on the drop when fishing spinnerbaits. Now once it's hit the bottom, I give it a jerk off the bottom just to get it out of weed and so it doesn't bump into rocks and I just start sort of a slow, steady retrieve, keeping the rod tip down and just give it a jerk every now and again just to give it a little bit more movement, make it look a little bit different and make it stand out really to the fish. This is quite a dulled spinnerbait I've got on here because the water we're fishing in at the moment is quite clear.
Well, what we've done for our final attempt is come back to the spot where we were successful earlier on. Sam had his big fish out of here, £2.07. I had a few little plucks and lots of follows on the drop shot. So Sam's now drop shotting. I've put a little tiny jig head on with a paddle tail. Well, after all that, my perseverance has paid off, albeit not in the way I was hoping. It's a perch, instantly recognisable as such, but it's not quite in the league of the fish we were hoping for and expecting, but any fish is better than no fish, and that's definitely a fish. Angry little devil too, isn't he? Look. But I think that's completely my enjoyment for the day. I've caught a fish, the rain's still coming down, I'm going home. I actually said that it was recorded, but it didn't make the cut, that I'll be glad when I've had enough of this enjoying myself, because that was a horrible day.
We've had a lot of horrible days.
But the worst part about it was, it said in the morning there'll be moderate rain. When I got there, it was only spitting, so I left my waterproof jacket in the car, put my wind stopper on because it was quite breezy and quite chilly, and it rained them every layer. I was only on the back, I was soaked. I had lightweight waterproof trousers, they kept me dry, but boy, I was cold by the end of that day. But Sam is just, and Gary, of course, they're outstanding. I mean, Sam so knows his stuff, and you must have had great fun with them on the World Championships.
Well, of course, it was the first time I'd met Sam and Gary, and we got on very well. The whole team got on very well. And yeah, you're right, they're both great anglers. I like to think we were all pretty good anglers, but they are very good anglers indeed. Yeah. Interestingly, of all the teams that went to the World Championships, we were the only team that took our families.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we were the only ones. And of course, they're a family unit themselves.
Yeah, yeah.
Makes them very close, makes them good boat partners.
Brilliant. Welcome back. Pike specialist Eric Edwards has joined me in the body this week. And I know, Eric, that one of the hats you wear is that of development officer at the Pike Anglers Club of Great Britain. Now, I think the Pike Anglers Club do a fantastic job because they carry the good message of pike. And you know, I'm probably best known as a match angler, although I'm a lapsed match angler. And there's a great theory that match anglers hate pike. One won me £240 once, but that's another story. But they are a good indicator of a healthy river system. How does the development officer for the Pike Anglers Club of Great Britain get that message across?
Firstly, the Pike Anglers Club was formed because of this anti-pike sentiment. It was formed 35 years ago. Mm. And to a large extent, the education message that the Pike Anglers Club have put out has got through. And now most people respect the role that a pike plays in a balanced fishery. Our role has somewhat changed then. We're no longer just fighting the cause of just trying to stop people throwing pike up the bank. What we're trying to do now is educate and inform and help people to enjoy their pike fishing. Now, we've got quite a big coaching scheme going now. I managed to procure a lottery grant last year for over £9,000.
Brilliant.
And we've put 26 people in training as coaches. Most of them are now trained. And the Pike Anglers Club nationally has something like 40 qualified coaches.
Wow.
We're doing coaching days to angling clubs, to wildlife organisations. We work with the RSPB, lots of different organisations, and we offer this a service from the club, teaching people how to catch pike in a safe manner. Mm. Because the one thing you can say about pike is they are dangerous creatures. Mm. And the tackle that we use to catch pike is equally dangerous.
To the fish. Well, yeah, we can see that on some. Now, we'll get to these in just a second, but that's an important message. And I know there are lots of clubs now, as part of their membership, have a pike ticket that you can't go and fish for pike. You'll be a club member. You can't target pike without having passed some kind of test to prove that you know what the long pliers are for, you know what the mat's for, you know how to hold them, you're not frightened of them and that sort of stuff. And that's where PAC gets involved.
Yeah, that's a good thing. Lots of clubs are doing this off their own bat. But what I would say is, if you want to do this, if you're running a club and you want to put in a pike proficiency scheme, call me, call the PAC, and we'll help you do it the best way.
Fantastic. Right, now let's have a look at some hardware. You've brought that rod in with you, and that That's a bit of a stick, that. It's a bit of a broom handle. Is this a joke? Is it Rod used for joke baits?
That's my heavy joke bait rod, yeah.
It is a heavy rod as well. But joke baits, heavy things, and you've got to work them through the water. And this is what... Now, I know it's, as you saw in our film there, we're all on braid. Mm. And this is braid, but this is quite substantial for drop shotting. I use 0.08 braid, which is about 8-9 pound breaking strain. This is thicker.
This is 100 pound braid.
100 pound?
100 pound braid.
Wow.
And the reason we use such heavy braid in jerkbait fishing in particular is because jerkbait fishing is extremely hard on tackle. Mm. A jerkbait, some of the lures here, this lure here, would weigh 12 ounces, up to 12 ounces. And casting a heavy lure again and again, and then the actual jerking action through the water of pulling and yanking and pulling, is very hard on tackle. Mm. And although this is substantial stuff, I've actually cracked off on this, on the cast,
wow,
on 100-pound braid. Not often,
no,
but I have done it.
And do you change, like, the bit that goes... I know one thing that I learned when I was fishing with wire line for striped bass, bizarrely enough, in Montauk, Long Island, New York. They make you let out a little bit more line every third or fourth cast, so you're not... We were jigging, so you're not jigging on exactly the same bit. Do you change the length of this so you can cast... So you're not casting the same metre of braid every time?
Not really. What I tend to do is just cut it back when I need to.
Yeah.
If I've got to tie on a new trace or something like that, or if the braid becomes damaged. Because the one thing about braid and where it falls down against mono is it's susceptible to damage by objects in the water. Mm. You've got to watch that.
That's interesting as well. I'm just looking at this. You've got a crimped single-strand trace. Normally, you see a braided trace.
Yeah, now, the reason we use single-strand on jerk baiting is, you see how stiff that,
yeah,
is?
Yeah.
When you're jerk baiting and you flick the rod and the lure comes towards you, it can actually overtake the trace. Now, if you're using a flexible trace, that trace is then going to get, yeah, bound up in the hooks, whereas a stiff trace gets pushed out of the way by the lure. And that's why we use stiff traces for jerkbait fishing particularly. That's a titanium trace.
Really?
It's 100-pound titanium. And the great thing about titanium is, because it doesn't kink,
yes,
you're not going to have to change it every few fish.
Now, I've got a bit of a trick question now. You've got 100-pound braid, 100-pound trace. What happens when you hook the bottom?
If it's a small part of the bottom, I can usually bring it in.
If it's walk over across the other side.
If it's a big part of the bottom, like an old car or something like that, I've got a bit of a trick, actually, which I use, which stops me from losing my lures. If you look at this lure here...
Let me take it and then, yeah, you can just show us.
This lure's got rated split rings on the hooks. When I say rated, when,
yeah,
I say rated, what I mean is they're rated to snap at a certain breaking strain.
Ah,
now,
yeah.
These are commercially available from various websites. And these ones I have on here are rated to snap at 50 pounds.
50 pounds. So that's clever.
Now, I've tested these with... heavy weights. Don't test them against your scales because
you ruin your
scales. I've tested these with heavy weights and I know that they break at 50 pounds.
Mm.
So if I cast this lure in with my 100 pound braid on the rod and 100 pound titanium trace and 50 pound split rings, if I hook the bottom, all I have to do is wrap the braid, put around a piece of wood. Don't do it with your fingers.
No.
Wrap it around a piece of wood, an old branch or something, give it a tug, the split ring snaps. I get my lure back, all I have to do is put another split ring and hook.
Now, you've brought in some highly mysterious lures here. Now, I've already christened this the Sideshow Bob, but it's got a different name, hasn't it?
This is called a Medusa. I was over in America last month. I visited the Chicago Muskie Show, and these things are all the rage for catching muskies.
Wow.
That, you might think that's a big lure, that actually is one of the smaller ones. Some of the lures they were using were huge.
Wow. And that's obviously very much a caricature of something that a fish might occasionally eat. This is just about the most lifelike, realistic reproduction,
yeah,
I've ever felt of a lure. It actually feels like an eel.
It looks like an eel.
It looks like an eel.
It swims like an eel.
It does swim like an eel.
Cast it out and bring it in, it's an eel.
I've used these myself. I've not used this king-size one, but I've used them myself, and they are really lifelike in the water.
Yeah.
Unbelievably. You had any success on these?
I've hardly used this one, and because of this winter we've had it, I only bought it at the start of the winter.
Mm.
I've not had much chance to get out with it. But being lifelike isn't the be-all and end-all of lure fishing, and that that lure you've got there doesn't look anything like anything.
Sort of a beer might suit me sometimes.
Yeah, it probably would.
Now, this is a sort of a version of what Sam was using in that perch film.
A spinnerbait.
On the top pound, that's right. A spinnerbait. And you'd think you've got to be, like, a bit of an idiot fish to mistake that for something that's ever lived.
Let's be clear. Fish are idiots. Fish are not like people. They have a pike has got a brain the size of a pea, and it doesn't have a thought process like you and I.
Yeah.
99% of what a pike does, it reacts.
Yeah.
It might think a little bit, but mostly it reacts. When something really foreign, an alien, comes into its field of vision like that, the first thing that goes through its head is, can I eat it? Let's have a go.
That's not bad, actually, is it? But, you know, I go back a long way in my fishing, even further than you. And when I used to go piking when I was a boy, the thing you had to have was a copper spoon. And there is a copper spoon, and that's not changed. Even the hooks look the same as when I was 13 or 14 years old and getting my gear from Mr. Whaley's in Hornsey Road.
Copper spoons catch fish just as well now, yeah, as they did when you were a boy.
They're amazing things as well. I've caught on the drop, I've caught on the retrieve. I've had pike, when I've finished the retrieve, come out the water, and I've lifted it out the water, chased the flipping thing out the water. They are just unbelievable catches of fish.
They're very good shallow water lures. They're very good for catching fish that perhaps haven't seen a hook before or haven't seen many hooks before. They have some disadvantages. They're not good casters. Casting certainly a small light spoon like this on a multiplier would be difficult.
Yeah.
A bigger spoon like this one, you can cast okay, but even then, some of these big soft plastics cast a lot better, but spoons work well.
Give us sort of almost a one-word answer, which we'll discuss in the later part of the show. Lures or bait?
Oh, that's a very tough one.
The answer should have been yes.
In terms of enjoyment, there's no question lure fishing absolutely beats bait fishing by a mile.
As far as coarse fishing on still waters is concerned, carp will continue to feed while the water temperature hovers around 7 degrees Celsius. Below that, it's time for roach and skimmers. And if you've got them in a fishery near you, F1s. You can fish far lighter now than in summer, and don't think you have to fish a pole. A well-presented waggler setup is far more likely to catch fish than a pole rig that's being blown to hell and back. Keep feed relatively light, just half a dozen 2 or 4 mil pellets, already softened a bit can help, and the same amount of maggots or casters, but remember, maggots will disappear into soft silt or between pebbles, so feed those a little bit more often than the more inert baits. And with Eric here in the body, our main focus is on predators, and in the many large pits and lakes around the country, pike are getting to their biggest weights. The big old girls will probably appreciate a decent mouthful, some of those lures you showed us, but bait fishing. Now we've got, it's not too cold, there's a bit of colour in the water, and bait fishing is still very, very popular.
Yeah, I fish lures and baits probably in equal measure, so I do quite a bit of bait fishing. Most of my bait fishing is done on very big waters, deep water, and I usually fish from a boat.
Well, you've bought in a couple of rigs, and I didn't realise this is heavily loaded.
It's heavily loaded. It's got over an ounce of lead in it.
Wow.
Yeah.
And it's got, coming down the rig a bit as well, you've got a fair old drill bullet there too.
It's a 3-ounce drill bullet. Yeah, and the reason I use a drill bullet rather than a pearl head is because there's less likelihood of a tangle on the cast. Drill bullets don't wrap around things as easily. So, and you'll see also there's a little spacer there between the drill bullet and the float. It's about an inch of stiff plastic.
Yeah.
And again, that helps prevent tangles on the cast.
Wow. And the standard... Oh, this is a braided wire trace this time. Is that still
That's
titanium?
Braided titanium, yeah. Okay. Yeah. And you'll notice too, I'm not using an up trace. There's a lot of debate in pike circles as to whether you should use an up trace for dead baiting. I don't. I haven't done for 30 years, and I've never been bitten off with a rig like this.
I think it's pretty... A couple of other floats, I mean, long gone are the days of the old Fishing Gazette and the pilot float above it. Do you remember the bung and the pilot float?
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Every float has got its own purpose now.
And we spoke about the big waters and the big reservoirs, and there's a couple of really noticeable fish, I mean, notable fish. This one, Wind and Cool, caught this from Wycombe. Thanks to the Angling Times for the picture, obviously. And that's a massive fish, 46.11. That's not a particularly big water, is it?
It's quite a small water, and 46.11 is just 2 ounces off the British record.
Unbelievable.
I've got to say, I would love to catch that fish, but I wouldn't like it to go over the British record. Mm. I think it would be a shame for a targeted fish to take the record. Yeah. Bit too much like carp fishing for me, that.
Yeah, we're calling it Cyril next. And this is an interesting bit as well. This is from the Angler's Mail, and it's Wickham versus Chew for the pike record, and Chew's produced a couple of massive fish, 44.6.
There was a 44.6 from one of the my region's PAC members, in fact.
Was it?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well done him. So practice what he preaches.
Yeah, yeah. Some huge fish coming from Chew, and who would say that Chew wouldn't do a record? Yeah. I would rather it come from Chew than Wycombe, I must say.
Yeah, and you know, some people are calling the Chew fish and saying, oh, it's nothing more than an overstocked stock pond. What's your views on that?
Chew's a complete lottery. I fished Chew for one day last week. I caught nothing at all. Neville Fickling caught nothing. Paul Garner caught nothing. Other people caught huge fish. But it really is nothing more than a lottery. You cast your bait in, a fish takes it or a fish doesn't.
Yeah. But you if, for want of a better expression, you count them. They're proper fish.
Well, yeah. It's a big water, and really, pike fishing's all about big waters, rough conditions.
700 acres or 1,200 acres?
1,200.
1,200 acres, yeah. I've always mixed up with Grafham, which is 770, I think. Probably bigger than that now. But you also fish a lot of natural waters. You mentioned the Wye and the Severn. Do you ever get on the other side of the country into the Fens, which, of course, the Norfolk Broads produce that huge fish for
very rarely,
Mr. Gobble?
The Broads is a place I've not fished for more than 20 years. It's just a long way from me.
Yeah.
I mean, I live in the northwest. It's a long drive. I'd rather go to somewhere like the Wye.
Yeah, and you prefer, as you say, the big waters. I know you do a lot of your fishing from a boat, and you fish the lakes, I think, as well.
I fish the Lake District quite a lot.
Yeah.
And to be honest, the pike fishing in the Lake District's getting much, much harder.
Is it?
I'm not sure why.
You think it's angling pressure, maybe?
Angling pressure's certainly playing a part. But the other thing I've noticed in the past 2 years is that the prey fish have disappeared. It's very difficult to find prey fish, whereas there used to be vast shoals of roach and perch. I can't find them anymore.
That's always a worry. Now, just to finish up, and we said bait or perch, and you sort of scratched your chin, bait or lures, rather, you scratched your chin a bit, and we've only concentrated on pike, so we'll stick to pike. Lure fish, I love lure fish, and I find it really enjoyable. If you were given... You're not going to be given the choice, what do you want to do, but if you were, what would it be?
If I had to choose?
Yeah.
It would be lure fishing.
Yeah. And a nice mobile approach, little pack on your back.
Very mobile.
Yeah.
That's the way I work. I usually go out with just one rod, small bag with some lures, a camera, and I might walk miles. I might fish 30 to 40 swims in a day.
Wow.
To catch those fish, but it's great fun. The great thing about lure fishing is having the rod in your hand when something three feet long would wallop.
And the great thing for me is I'm old enough now to have a bus pass. Got to get the bus, go to the canal, get another bus home. It's brilliant. That's it for today. A reminder, you can find all sorts of features on our website. And you can follow us on Twitter as well. And please keep your young angler photos coming in via email. Thanks for coming, Eric. It's been a real pleasure. I've always enjoyed chatting. It's been
great
fantastic.
To be here.
Thanks very much, mate. Next week, the focus is on fly fishing. My guest will be Lucy Bowden, a qualified Level 2 coach and founder of the Fishing for Everyone Ladies Club. Join us at 7 p.m. on Sky Sports 3. That's next week's show. We guest Lucy Bowden, 7 o'clock, Sky Sports 3. If you miss us, don't forget the show's available every week on demand in the Sky Sports section of Catch Up, as well as some other great films from past programmes, so check that one out. Hope the weather's kinder to you. Take care. Tight lines. Cheers, mate. Thanks very much. That was lovely. And that's a wacko. Oh.
Watch all six Sky Sports channels on your mobile and online.